Conquering the sound barrier took multiple years of hard labor and ingenuity. Designers had to create engines suitable for flying at least transonic speeds, adapt the airframe to the new environment, change the wing shape, and make it durable enough to sustain supersonic loads. Last but not least, the anticipated sonic boom needed to eventually go from an achievement to a routine event, and that meant that all the cutting-edge solutions had to be as simple and cheap as possible. The first attempts to breach the sound barrier were made by the pilots of fast prop planes during World War II, like the Thunderbolts and the Spitfires. These machines could achieve truly impressive speeds in dives. Coupled with some measurement error, it might have felt like approaching the sound barrier. The reality was much more complicated, of course. Even the fastest prop plane ever made was unlikely to go supersonic. Back in the 1930s, scientists came to a depressing conclusion. The more powerful piston engines got, the bigger diameter they required for their propellers. It meant that a plane would need a propeller of an immense size to achieve transonic speeds, and its blade tips would start breaching the sound barrier way earlier than the aircraft itself, lowering its efficiency. That was the primary reason why scientists focused on jet and rocket engines. Nevertheless, the new types of engines didn't magically solve all problems. One such example was a crash that happened in 1943 during the flight tests of the Soviet prototype rocket-powered plane called the BI. The machine was almost sucked into a dive due to its straight wing. The scientists studied the crash, performed tests in a wind tunnel, and discovered that flying faster than 800 kilometers an hour required new geometry for the wing. Meticulous calculations coupled with the new data from German Comets and Schwalbes pointed to the swept shape. Ironically, the first plane to break the sound barrier happened to have a classic straight wing, but that was more of an exception. On the 14th of October, 1947, the Bell X-1 managed to go supersonic in a level flight at an impressive altitude of 12,200 meters. Despite that achievement, engineers from various parts of the world picked swept wings for mass-produced supersonic fighters. Another useful invention came at the end of the 1940s. The so-called area rule is a design procedure that allows engineers to reduce an aircraft's drag at transonic and supersonic speeds. And so, by the 1950s, the visual design of airplanes had changed dramatically compared to only a few years earlier. Airframe durability issues were solved by using new materials such as titanium alloys, and more powerful engines made the task of breaching the sound barrier surmountable. It was finally time for mass-produced supersonic fighters. The first heralds of the new era were the American F-100 Super Sabre and the MiG-19. In only a few years, going over Mach 1 stopped being a miracle. From then on, combat aviation would develop in leaps and bounds for a few decades in a row. Towards the end of the Cold War, the top speed of fighters didn't even play a major role anymore. The focus shifted to advanced electronics, weapons, cost-effectiveness, and other parameters. Still, supersonic flight has been routine ever since, and some aircraft can even achieve it without using their afterburners.